Hello and welcome. I am Lillian Wori. Do you know anyone who is so passionate in seeing our nation do well on agriculture as Senator Adamu Alero, the former Minister of FCT, the former Governor of Kebbi State, and now the Senator representing Kebbi Central in the Senate? His passion is on farming and making good laws for our nation. What more do you know about this Senator? Sit back as we take you through the journey of his trials.
Muhammad Adamu Alero was born on the 1st of January 1957 into the family of Alhaji Adamu Alero in Alero local government area of Kebbi State. He was governor of Kebbi State from 29th of May 1999 to 29th May 2007. He received his primary education at an Islamic school. His elementary education commenced in 1965 at Alero Town Planning School. He then attended the government secondary school in Koko and obtained his secondary school leaving certificate in 1976. He gained admission into the Ahmadu Bello University Zaria and graduated in 1980 with a Bachelor in Political Science. In 1981, Senator Adamu Alero began his working career as an administrative officer at the College of Education in Sokoto State and joined the Nigerian Customs and Excise Service in the same year. In 1997, he voluntarily resigned from the Nigerian Customs Service and joined active politics under the platform of the defunct United Nigerian Congress Party, UNCP. In 1998, he contested and won the Senate seat representing Kebbi Central Senatorial District, which the result was annulled. In 1999, Senator Muhammad Adamu Alero became the gubernatorial flag bearer of All People's Party, APP, and won the election. He was sworn in on the 29th of May 1999 and was re-elected in 2003. He remains one out of the four incumbent governors of All Nigerian People's Party governors to maintain his position. He contested the April 2007 general elections for the Senate and won. He then left the Senate to take up ministerial appointment as the Minister of the Federal Capital Territory under the government of late President Umaru Musa Eradua until it was dissolved in March 2010 by President Goodluck Ebele Jonathan. In 2014, Senator Adamu Alero joined the All Progressive Congress, APC, and contested election for the Senate and won the seat representing Kebbi Central Senatorial District during the 2015 general elections. Being a lawmaker who is passionate to legislative activities and particularly in the agricultural development of Nigeria, Senator Adamu Alero's strides on the floor of the Senate cannot be undermined. He is one of the senators with bills and motions centered around the growth and development of our nation, Nigeria. Such bills are Amendments on Medical and Dental Practitioners Act, CAP 2004, a bill for act to provide for establishment of the Federal Referral Hospital in the six geopolitical zones of the country, to bridge the existing gap between the primary secondary health care and tertiary health care service delivery, reduce less of foreign exchange lost for medical tourism from Nigeria. A bill for an act to establish the Nigerian Audiology Council. The act will regulate the practice of audiology. Bill for an act to amend National Center for Agricultural Mechanization Act, CAP N13 2004, which seek to provide for private sector participation, promotion of commercial agriculture, and for other related matters therewith. He also sponsored motions such as the dangers posed by removal of rice from import duty payment at land borders, investigation of importation of maize into the country, the revenue mobilization, allocation, and fiscal commission to discharge its constitutional function under paragraph 32 of the third schedule of the 1999 constitution. The failing standard of education in Nigeria and gruesome killing of 40 people in Sokoto State and many more. It is worth stating that Senator Adamu Aliru did not just occupy this top position of responsibility for nothing. He made positive impact in each and every one of them. Arguably, his two terms as executive governor of Kebbi State were the high points of his record of service, followed by his face-setting tenure as FCT minister. The tremendous transformation of Kebbi State from rural state to a role model in the Northwest geopolitical zone and indeed the country remains a service of scope of development and time span unmatched. In the Senate, his mark is felt on the floor of the Senate and his senatorial district are not left out. As he helped in constructing one block of three classrooms each for primary schools in his district in places like Janzomo Primary School, Godangaji Primary School, Marmara in Aleru, Jega DGSS in Jega, Aida in Mayema local government, Kashinzama and Jiga Birni in Aleru, Gehuru Primary School in Jega, Atahiru Primary School, Etene Primary School in Kalgo, Adam Suleiman Model Primary School, Alelu in Jega local government, Gwandu Town, Nizamiya Primary School, Kalgo Town, Dusumari and Mammawa in Gwandu local government areas. This was not all, as the senator representing Kebbi Central also constructed solar-powered borehole in different locations like Kimba in Jega local government, Ruampili in Mayema, Gorkomodo in Gwandu, Tsola Dangoma in Kalgo, Yanga in Bachaka, Rugar Balko in Aleru, Owa in Bonza local government, Wararin Zoramawa in Gwandu, Jiga Makela in Aleru, Bodoro in Kalgo, Tungar Maipada Gulumbe in Birnin Kebbi to strengthen and help in the nation building. Senator Adamu Aliru distributed 8 of 406 cars, 500 motorcycles to party chairmen and supporters in Kebbi Central. He also gave out 1,200 bags of fertilizers to support farmers with 500 water pumps. Women and children were not left out of the goodwill of distinguished Senator Muhammad Adamu Aliru, as he distributed 3,000 sewing machines and 500 grinding engines to encourage the spirit of entrepreneurship. The distinguished senator provided solar street light in places like Muhammad Dodo Road in Jega, Adam Suleiman Road in Aleru, Gwandu Town along Market Road. Senator Aliru, who is the Garkuan Gwandu, believes that light is life and access to it is power. This led to provision of 500 KBA transformers, each to Birnin Kebbi, Kalgo, Jega, Aleru, Mayema, Kokobese, Bonza, and Gwandu local government areas respectively. Indeed, the good people of Kebbi Central Senatorial District is well represented on the floor of the upper chamber of the National Assembly in the person of Senator Muhammad Adamu Aliru.
Welcome back. If you're just joining us, this is Bold Stride. Today we are looking at the strides of Senator Adamu Aliru, the former FCT minister, the former governor of Kebbi State, and the senator representing Kebbi Central in the Senate. Bostride had a chat with a distinguished senator who shed more light on his activities in the Senate. Today on Bostride, I have a former minister, a former governor, and he's now a senator representing Kebbi Central, distinguished Senator Adamu Muhammad Aliru. Sir, you're welcome to Bow Street, sir.
Thank you very much,
sir. There's this thing now in the Senate that most of the executive governors, they all rush, they all want to come and retire in the Senate. What do you feel is the need for this, and why are they in the Senate?
Well, there is no rush about it. It's just the interest people have in coming to serve their country. Maybe after you finish as a governor, and you want to continue contributing your quota to the development of your country, the next place for you to go is actually the Senate. If you are not appointed as a minister, or if you don't get a slot as a vice presidential candidate, the only place you can go to continue, you know, helping your country, helping your people, is the Senate. And in doing so, there are a number of things you can do when you go to the Senate. Whatever affects the welfare and well-being of Nigerians, you should be seen to be promoting it. You should sponsor bills that will assist the ordinary people. You should sponsor bills that will move the country progressively from a less developed country to a developed country. You should sponsor bills and motions that will bring peace and stability in your country. You should sponsor bills and motions that will assist in mutual coexistence among the various ethnic groups and religious groups in the country. And this is what we need for now. And we need people with a lot of experience, people that serve as governors, people that serve in the civil service to the extent of becoming permanent secretaries or directors. When they come to the Senate, they will bring their experience to bear. And this is why it is important to have people of higher management capacity to be in the Senate. They know what the grassroots is, being a governor. They know what the interests of the people are. And when they come to the center, I mean to the Senate, they'll do their very best to advance those interests. Other than this, I don't think there is any other reason. It cannot be personal.
As a former minister and also as a former governor of Kebbi State and now a senator, how will your experience, your wealth of experience, help in your legislative duties?
Oh yeah, of course. Even during debates or motions or bills, there are many things that we see, and you start reflecting what it should be when you are governor, what it should be when you are minister, and then if there is anything that you see that is wrong, you always put it right, and your colleagues will agree with you. Our interest borders on serving the people, and this interest has to be connected with what your constituency is all about. Your constituency maybe is one of the educationally backward states, and maybe your constituency is ravaged by Boko Haram or insurgency in the Niger Delta, or is being ravaged by the bandits that are called herdsmen. If you know how these people are as a minister, and if you know how they are as a governor, when you come to the Senate, you will be able to come up with suggestions and solutions that will bring peace and harmony in the society.
What are the challenges you have being a senator?
Whatever challenges we face or I face, I take it as part of life, and we'll continue. There cannot be life without challenges. Otherwise, it will be monotonous. The interesting thing about challenges is that it makes you to learn, and it also makes you hardened, and it makes you determined to surmount such challenges.
We have senators, we have constituents, we have people agitating for different things. As a lawmaker, what have you been able to attract to the people you represent in the Senate?
Well, if you are talking about achievements as it relates to KB, I wouldn't put it that way. As a senator, you are a senator of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. And the whole, you know, country should be your major focus, not necessarily your state or your constituency. If you want to narrow it down, maybe you narrow it down to the issue of citing certain projects in your constituency or in your state. If there's budget that is coming, you ensure that your state is adequately taken care of. If there is a road that needs rehabilitation, you ensure that that road is in the budget. If there are challenges concerning erosion, you ensure that that budget takes care of the challenges of erosion in your constituency. If it's desertification, for example, you also ensure that that budget takes care of certain aspect of environmental hazards connected with desertification. These are things you should do, and these are things that affect the whole country. So even though you are a senator of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, but your primary responsibility is to ensure that your constituency or your state is taken care of by federal government. And challenges that face your state, you always bring them to the fore so that they can get the attention of the federal government. At times, you don't even have to discuss them in the National Assembly. You can go and discuss with the minister in charge of works, if it is road rehabilitation you want to do. If it is environmental problems your state is facing, you go and see the AGF, who happens to be in charge of the ecological funds, where disbursement is done after getting approval from the president. So, as a senator, your interest is the whole country. But if you narrow it down, maybe you talk about constituency projects that you get, which are considered to be very, very insignificant. Because as a senator, you may not get more than 150 million naira to go and drill a borehole here, build a primary school there, buy motorcycles or KK Nepa for your people. This is one aspect of representation that senators are always, you know, fond of talking, the constituency project.
You are one of the vocal voices when issues on agriculture is raised on the floor of the Senate. Why the interest in agriculture?
Well, agriculture is the mainstay of Nigeria's economy. We are not an industrialized country, and we cannot generate jobs in the industrial sector that can take care of the teeming number of people we have that are unemployed. And we have many able-bodied men that are roaming the streets of our cities without employment. And the surest way of employing people in Nigeria is in agriculture. That is number one. Number two, as a country, it's not good for us to be importing food. We have all it takes to produce enough food for ourselves and even export. But lack of policies and programs from a successive government have made it impossible. But this government has come up boldly to come with various solutions that will make us to produce enough food for our country or for our teeming people, and perhaps even export. And thirdly, if you are in a position to do this, it makes you to save the little foreign exchange you have. Instead of using foreign exchange to to buy food, like maybe to buy wheat, rice, chicken, frozen chicken, and what have you. You make your own people to produce them. You save the foreign exchange. You generate employment within the economy. You are adding value to whatever you have within the country. And your people will be satisfied. And all the problems unemployment we have can largely be solved by embarking on agricultural policies and programs that will boost agricultural production in this country. Where we have problems of lack of water, or rainfall rather, you use irrigation. It's still part of agriculture. That's why when this bill on water resources bill came up, I came up and defended it very well. But unfortunately, there are people that look at it narrowly. And this is a bill, when passed, the country stand to benefit a lot. Over $1.5 billion is going to be spent on improving irrigation facilities in Nigeria. And every zone is going to benefit from this $1.5 billion. But simply because they start with a particular geopolitical zone, people became, you know, sensitive to it. That, why not our own zone? Why not my own state? When you look at things narrowly, you end up, you know, killing what is good for the country. So, agriculture, I will continue to say, is the mainstay of our economy. And from agriculture, we can even graduate to becoming an industrialized country, because developed nations first started with agriculture. They developed it to the extent that the raw materials they require, they got it from agriculture. And from there, they set up agro-allied industries. And this agro-allied industry graduate to major industrial complex. So there is nothing that stops us from doing what they did to become great nations today. Unfortunately, policy inconsistencies or policy somersaults are largely responsible for drawing us back. But this government has taken giant strides by insisting that whatever we are doing, we have to sustain it, we have to be consistent, we have to be steadfast and ensure that it is done properly. And we build on whatever progress we achieve within the last 1 year or 2 years, 3 years, you know, so that we will have unbroken development. I'll give you an example. When this government came, there was importation of rice. And the previous government gave import duty waivers for people to bring in rice. President Buhari remembered what he told the electorate, Nigerian electorate, during the electionary campaign, that he will focus attention on agriculture. And some of us called his attention to this waiver that was given, and he moved in and canceled that waiver. And that's why nobody is granted waiver to import rice today. Unless, of course, if it is an international organization that won't donate food to refugees in Nigeria. And even that, we are saying that if they want to donate food, let them buy rice produced in Nigeria, not rice produced in Thailand or in India or in Vietnam. Whatever you want to do, do it within the country.
That is all we have for you today on Bold Stride. I guess you agree with me that my guest today is so passionate in moving the agricultural sector forward. Till I come your way again next week, I am Lillian Wori saying goodbye and God bless.